workshop on mass in the standard model. Next talk is by Jorge Segovia on baryon elastic and transition form factor. So you can go ahead, Jorge.
Okay, thanks. Good evening to everyone, at least from Europe. First of all, let me thank the organizers for giving me the opportunity to present my research work here. Today, I'm going to talk about elastic and transition electromagnetic form factors of nucleon and delta resonances within the framework of continuum swing of functional methods. Let me also tell you that this research line is mostly conducted with the collaboration of my Chinese colleagues at the University of Nanjing. So we all know that one of the main goals of nuclear and particle physics is to study the properties of hadrons in terms of the elementary excitations of quantum chromodynamics, which are quarks and gluons. QCD is well understood in its high energy regime, where perturbative QCD calculations and many experiments in the last 50 years has established QCD as the quantum field theory of the strong interaction. However, hadrons live in its non-perturbative regime, when in principle many low-level rules produce high-level phenomena with an enormous apparent complexity. So what that means? So if one starts from the QCD Lagrangian that can be written in 1 to 2 lines, one needs to apply a very well-based theoretical tool such as lattice regularized QCD or continuum swing of functional methods in order to obtain, among other features, the following ones: the generation of a dynamical fundamental mass scale in pure jump mills, what we call the gluon mass, the production of quark constituent masses and its relation with dynamical chiral symmetry breaking, explanation of description of bound state formation in quantum field theory, not only for conventional hadrons such as mesons and baryons, but also explaining exotic states as glue balls, hybrids, and multi-quark systems. And finally, one hopes to get some signals of confinement. So one can realize that neither of these phenomena, emergent phenomena, is apparent in the QCD Lagrangian. However, they characterize the non-perturbative regime of QCD where hadrons live. And from a quantum field theoretical point of view, this emergent phenomena could be associated with dramatic, dynamically driven changes in the analytic structure of QCD's Schwinger functions, which are propagators and vertices. And they are the solutions of the Dyson-Schwinger equations, which are the quantum equations of motions of QCD. So I show you here some examples of the lowest endpoint Dyson-Schwinger equations. The most famous one is the gap equation. It tells us simply that the inverse of the Dres quark propagator is equal to the inverse of the bar quark propagator plus a self-energy term, where other solutions of the Dyson-Schwinger equations, like the Dres gluon propagator and the Dres quark gluon vertex, appear in order to solve this equation. Therefore, we need to solve simultaneously many of these Dyson-Schwinger equations, and one can imagine that we have an infinite number of coupled differential equations and we need to truncate them. In fact, we are usually talking about the Riemann-Lada truncation, which is the leading order truncation in this theoretical framework. But one needs to go beyond Riemann-Lada truncation in order to explain properties of higher excited states of hadrons, for example, as Garnot explained before. So if one is brave enough in order to solve these kinds of equations, one arrives to their solutions. I'm going to start first explaining the Dres gluon propagator in the Landau gates that can be written in the following form, where this scalar form factor that appears here is finite at very infrared. In fact, the inverse of this form factor can be associated with the so-called gluon mass, whose generation is given by the Schwinger mechanism. There is another important feature here, which is the existence of an inflection point at Q squared larger than zero, which breaks the axiom of reflection positivity. And many Dyson-Schwinger equations practitioners believe that this is a signal of having gluons inside confined hadrons. The existence of this gluon mass produces other interesting features. For example, the Dres function in the Gauss propagator is finite at the very infrared. And in fact, this allows us to combine the Dres gluon propagator and the Dres Gauss propagator in order to define what we call the process independent effective charge for QCD, which is given by the blue solid line that appears here. In this figure, one can see that the running of the strong coupling constant agrees with the perturbative QCD calculation at one loop at very high momentum. but also compares pretty nicely with the experimental data obtained from the effective process-dependent charge from the Jorgensen rule. The good point from there is that we cannot compare all, we can compare not only for very high momenta, but also for intermediate momentum transfer, momenta. And in fact, what we are doing is avoiding the Landau pole and getting a saturated value for the running of the strong coupling constant at k equal to zero, which is around pi. So this kind of running, this kind of the running of a strong coupling constant is introduced in our covariant bound state equations for hadrons, mesons and baryons, and it is describing the quark-quark and quark-quark anti-quark interaction. But in order to complete our description of the covariant bound state equations, we need also another ingredient, which is the dress quark propagator in Landau gates that can be written in the following form, where the mass term that appears in this denominator is the most important signal of dynamical chiral symmetry breaking. An early massless like quark acquires a dynamical momentum dependent mass, namely the constituent quark mass, and it is due to the gluon cloud. In fact, the constituent quark mass value at p equal to zero is around 300, 400 MeVs and explain 98% of the proton's mass, leaving the other 2% to the so-called Higgs mechanism. In fact, this dynamical chiral symmetry breaking mechanism is the mechanism that is responsible for almost all the visible mass in the universe and can be, and focusing on the Goldberger-Treiman relation at the quark level, one can see that one of the dressing functions in the quark propagator, it is related with the wave function of the pion, which is the pseudo-Wollstone boson of the of QCD. So this kind of this relation here is the cleanest expression of the mechanism that is responsible for all this visible mass in the universe. So if one has an interaction that is able to create Goldstone bosons as bound states of a light dress quark and a light dress antiquark, this interaction also will generate a strong color anti-triplet correlations between any two dress quarks. And owing to the properties of charge conjugation, a quark with spin parity JP may be viewed as a partner of the analogous G minus P meson. That means that we need to solve the same Bethe-Salpeter equation with only two differences. The first one is the color factor that appears here for the quark Bethe-Salpeter equation, and the second one is the C matrix that is due to the exchange between an anti-quark leg by a quark leg. So in the past, many Dyson-Swinger equations practitioners solved the Bethe-Salpeter equation for the quarks in rainbow ladder truncation and obtain mass poles. And the masses, for example, for the scalar and axial vector quarks are given here. However, these quarks are color objects and they should disappear from the scattering matrix problem when going beyond rainbow ladder. But one can use these mass scales in order to express the strength and the range of the quark-quark correlations inside baryons, but not only baryons, also multi-quark systems. So if one wants to describe octet and decuplet baryons, one needs only a scalar and axial vector quarks. But if one wants to describe excited states such as radial excitations and orbital excitations, one needs not only a scalar and an axial vector quarks, but also the pseudo-scalar at the vector ones. And I'm giving you here an example of how to compute the masses for the scalar, pseudo-scalar, vector, and axial vector mesons, and from the Bethe-Salpeter, from those Bethe-Salpeter equations, obtaining the quark masses for their partners. And in fact, we can do the same game as lattice QCD calculations, varying the current quark mass that appears in the QCD Lagrangian, and see how our physical observables can behave with that parameter. So describing baryons within the quark-quark pizza implies that the binding energy is given by two contributions. The first one is related with the formation of tight quark correlations, and the second one is the quark exchange that is depicted here in the south area, which is the kernel. In fact, this exchange ensures that the quark correlations within the baryon are fully dynamical, so no quark holds a special role. The second important feature is that these exchanges or rearrangements guarantees that the baryon's wave function complies with Pauli statistics. So as a consequences, we have, for example, that all the spectrum predicted in the quark-quark pizza is quite similar to the one predicted by three constituent quark model and also by today's lattice QCD calculation. These modern d-quarks are very different from the old static point-like d-quarks idea that feature early attempts to explain the so-called missing resonant problems. And finally, we are mostly some of us are mostly dedicated to look for particular signals of having these dequar correlations inside variants and also multiquar systems. So in this slide, I give you here a taste of the spectrum that is obtained within the quar-dequar pizza. One can see that the spectrum compares pretty nicely with the experimental data. And in fact, we are predicting the correct ordering between the ROPA, the so-called ROPA resonance and its and the parity partner of the nucleon. This is mostly related with the fact that we are solving covariant bound state equations. And let me just emphasize this point, because when solving a covariant bound state equation, only the total spin and parity are good quantum numbers and not the orbital angular momentum and the spin of the particle, as it is the case for the non-relativistic framework. Therefore, many S-wave states traditionally interpreted in a non-relativistic constituent quark model could have also higher orbital angular momentum components in their wave functions. For example, the pion could have also P-wave states besides the S-wave components. And for the nucleon and delta, one can have S-wave, P-wave, D-wave, and even F-wave components in the wave function. And this is unavoidable if one solves the Poincaré covariant bound state equations, such as Bethe-Salpeter equations, Fadejev equations, etc. So I show you here an spectrum for variants. I could, and a theoretical framework, we can compute many properties of hadrons. In particular, I'm going to focus on the computation of elastic and transition electromagnetic form factors of nucleon resonances, mostly because two reasons. The first one is because they provide a unique window into the quark and gluon strata, giving distinctive information on the roles played by emergent phenomena in QCD. And the second one is the wide momentum range reached by experiment that allow us to prove the stated nucleon structures or resonances not only in the non-perturbative regime of QCD, but also in the transition regime between perturbative and non-perturbative scales of QCD. So there was a vigorous experimental program around the world. Today, nowadays, I think that class collaboration at Jefferson Lab is producing most of the experimental data related with transition electromagnetic form factors of nucleon resonances. They have multi-GV polarized current wave beams, large acceptance detectors, and polarized proton-neutron targets in such a way that one can, they are able to get very precise data for the two-body processes in a wide kinematics. So we can have in the final state pion nucleon, eta nucleon, kion hyperon. But if one wants to study higher higher excited states of nucleon resonances, one needs to go to complex reactions, like for example, the pion-pion nucleon in the final state. So I would like to highlight the wave page maintained by Viktor Mokiev about what is the worldwide experimental data related with telicity amplitudes or the electromagnetic form factors for the nucleon and delta resonances. I always go or visit this page in order to get the experimental data. And we are now with the class 12 experiment, we are now trying to answer a few questions. For example, what are the effective degrees of freedom if one goes from the low Q square to the very high Q square? We know that, for example, for the low Q square, there are two main components. The first one is the three dress quark core, and the second one is the meson baryon final state interaction. So what is usually called pion cloud, meson cloud, etc. And we can even prove particular QCD, particular important QCD objects such as the dress quark mass at not only low momentum, but also at an intermediate regime between non-perturbative and perturbative scales. So in the following 10-15 minutes, I'm gonna show you our theoretical results related with elastic and transition form factors of nucleon resonances. The first one, of course, should be the elastic form factors for the nucleon. In this slide, I show you the Dirac and Pauli form factors for the proton. The left panels are mostly focused on low momentum, of low momentum transfer, but and the right panels are mostly focused on very large momentum transfer. One can see in the left panels that our theoretical result is in fair agreement with the experimental data that is parameterized by the Kelly's functional method, let's say in this way. For the right panels, what one can see is that the scaling predicted by perturbative QCD calculations, if appears, it is mostly accidental, for example, in the case of the Pauli form factor for the proton. The same happens in the case of the neutron. I can show you here te dirá Campaoli form factors for the neutron, focusing mostly on the lower momentum transfer and for very large momentum transfer. There is a discrepancy here for the Dirac form factor of the neutron. This is mostly related because the Dirac form factor of the neutron is very small with respect, for example, the case of the proton. So other higher order contributions in the kernel could be important in the case of the neutron. For example, I need to mention that we are not taking into account meson exchanges in the kernel. So we are not taking into account meson baryon final state interactions in our Bethe-Salpeter-like equation. One can see in the right panels here that again the predictions of perturbative QCD are not fulfilled, at least for the momentum for the transfer momentum that we are plotting. And this, I think that it is a very important feature because if perturbative QCD calculations were right, at least for the momentum that we are able to analyze, this the electromagnetic, the ratio between the electric and magnetic charge form factor for the protons should be a constant. And we know nowadays that this is not true. In fact, the electromagnetic ratio for the proton decays almost linearly with the photon momentum. We are predicting a zero crossing at Q square around 10 GeV square. And the same zero crossing appears in the electromagnetic ratio for the neutron, but in this case for Q square equal to 20 GeV square. This is very far, this is not under the reach of Jefferson lab, but we are proposing to MESA the peak that could appear at Q square around 6 GeV square in order to distinguish between different theoretical computations. Okay, all this behavior related with the Dirac, with the electromagnetic form factors of the nucleon is mostly related with having quark-quark correlations inside baryons and also describing the wave function for a baryon with higher orbital angular momentum components. And in fact, a nice explanation related with the flavor-separated versions of the Dirac and Pauli form factors could be given by having scalar biquark correlations inside the proton. For example, you can see here that the Dirac and Pauli form factors of the d-quark contribution, it's much smaller, even suppressed with respect to u-quark contribution for the Dirac and Pauli form factors, and at least a very large momentum transfer in both cases. This is mostly related with the fact that a d-quark is usually in combination, it is more frequently in combination with a u-quark in order to form a scalar d-quark correlation inside the baryon. We know that the form factor has a suppression of 1 over q squared with respect to the case of having just a photon interacting with the quark, and this would explain perfectly well what is the suppression of this d-quark contribution of the Dirac and Pauli form factors. Let me just go to the case of the Hopper resonance. So using the same theoretical formalins and not changing any parameter of the framework, we have computed the properties of the first excited state. We are obtaining a mass for the so-called Hopper resonance of around 1.7 GeV. This is in agreement with the EVAC analysis of the pion nucleon scattering around the energy range of the Hopper. In fact, it is in agreement with the Barpol, which is 1.8 GeV. This is good news because we are not considering in the kernel of the baryon of the Faleyev equation meson baryon buff final state interactions, and we cannot compare with the experimental mass reported by PDG. We need to compare our theoretical results with the bar poles that appear in the EVAC analysis. So we can confirm that the meson baryon final state interactions for the ROPA reduce the Dresd quark core mass by 20%. We have analyzed that the Roper and nucleon have very similar wave functions and the quark content. And in fact, we know from quantum mechanics that a single zero in the S wave components of the wave function could indicate a radial excitation. We were looking for our dominant S wave components in the Roper resonance and see that we in fact have this zero crossing for the most dominant, for all of them, but for the most dominant component is quite clear. So we can test that this is a radial excitation of the nucleon. However, in order to penetrate the meson clouds of the Roper resonance and illuminate the 3-square core, we need to compute, it is mandatory to compute the nucleon to Roper transition from factors at very high photon momenta. And in fact, what we expect is that our theoretical results is in good agreement with the experimental data at intermediate and large momentum transfer. And the disagreement with the low momentum transfer is mostly related with this meson cloud contribution. We have estimated what is the meson cloud contribution for the equivalent Dirac and Pauli form factors and see that our theoretical results are quite robust for the case of the of intermediate and large momentum transfer. And this contribution is soft and disappears quickly.
5 minutes left.
Okay, thank you very much. So just let me pass this slide because it is related with the flavor separated versions of the Dirac and Pauli form factors for the nucleon to Roper transition. There is an experiment that it has been recently approved in order to measure these flavor separated versions of the Dirac and Pauli form factors. Let me just turn my attention to the computation of the delta 1232 and delta 1600. I'm going to highlight simply the most important features. The first one is that for the nucleon to delta reaction, there are three form factors that characterize such transition. One is the magnetic form factor in Ts convention, and the other two are the electric and Coulomb ratios, which are basically the electric and Coulomb form factors divided by the magnetic one. Usually, the experimental data has been presented in the Ash convention, and we know that in the Ash convention, the magnetic form factor falls faster than the dipole form. Many has viewed this as a conundrum, but there is no sound reason in order to expect that the magnetic form factor in the Ash convention decays faster than the dipole form. It's in fact the Jones Scadron convention that should exhibit such behavior. There are two main reasons in order to expect that this decays faster. One is meson cloud effects, which are quite important at very low momentum transfer. They are soft and disappear quickly. And the second one is the relation between the Jones Scadron and Nash conventions, in which appears a factor 1 over Q, which provides material damping for the case of the Nash convention. So let me just say that the electric and Coulomb ratios are very interesting because they are zero for SU6 symmetric constituent quark models, that they do not take into account higher orbital angular momentum components of the quarks inside baryons. Therefore, the electric and Coulomb ratios give you information about the deformation of the hadrons involved in the reaction for the nucleon and for the delta. And in fact, related with the modification of the transition car. So the most important message here is that both are completely different from zero. That means that we have a delta and a nucleon which are deformed. And if they are deformed, they should have higher orbital angular momentum components beyond the S-wave components. And this is the only way of getting such higher orbital angular momentum components in the wave function is solving covariant bound state equations. There is a zero crossing for the electric ratio. This is important because it's the only way of making compatible the experimental data with the predictions of perturbative QCD for this observable. And the predictions of perturbative QCD are mostly related with the Licity conservation arguments, and these arguments must be fulfilled for any theoretical framework. So it is very interesting to explore where is the zero crossing of the electric ratio, which is accessible experimentally. And finally, let me just tell you what is the difference between the delta 1600 and the Roper So the first thing that I would like to say is that the wave function and the quark content for the Roper is very similar to the case of the nucleon. In the case of the delta, this is different, at least for the higher orbital angular momentum components, having a dominant D wave with respect to S wave component, which is in fact a factor of two smaller than in the case of the ground state for the delta 1232. This should have consequences in the computation of the transition electromagnetic form factors. And in fact, I'm going to show you here the magnetic form factor in the case of the delta 1600. These two curves that appear here are all the theoretical predictions available today. One can see that there is a zero crossing for this magnetic form factor. This is because all the theoretical frameworks assumes that the delta 1600 is a radial excitation, and they put by hand a node in the wave function. Such a node produces this zero crossing. In our case, we have nodes for the S wave component, but not only for that, for P wave, for D wave, and the interference of all these components when computing the matrix elements produces the black solid line that appears here. which is in agreement with the only experimental data at the photon point and does not have the zero crossing. So we need to be careful about assuming which strata should be fine for the different nucleon and delta resonances. And just let me allow to see to show you that the Coulomb and electric ratio are clearly different from zero for the case of the delta 1600, and in fact bigger than in the case of its ground state, indicating that it is more deformed than the delta 1232, and indicating that there are higher orbital angular momentum components in the delta 1600. So we are continuing insisting on our purpose of getting an unified study of electromagnetic and elastic transition form factors of nucleon resonances using QCD kindred kernels and interaction vertices. And in these two slides, I just summarize what I tried to show you with my presentation. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Jorge. So any question for Jorge? Victor, please.
Jorge, thank you very much for your really excellent talk on demonstrating the importance for getting insight in hadron mass generation, both for ground and excited nucleon state structure. My question to you is, how important to measure simultaneously GE over GM zero crossing for proton and neutron in order to establish transition rate in the mass dependence of dressed quark mass function from fully dressed quark to almost perturbative QCD quark? Could we use this for justification of JLAB energy increase at high luminosity after 12 GV era?
What I can tell you for sure is that any Dyson Schwing, so any continuous Schwinger functional method that has computed the elastic form factors of the nucleon predicts such zero crossing. Such zero crossing should be related with having with describing the nucleon not only as an S wave state, but also taking into account P waves, D wave states in its wave function. What I know perfectly well is that the location of the zero, okay? So this is a common feature of the covariant bound state equation. This is the reason because we all of us are getting the zero crossing for both electromagnetic ratio of proton and neutron. Now, the location of the zero, for example, in the case of the proton, depends on the quark-quark interaction. And therefore, the point depends on, for example, the running of the strong coupling constant and how the dressing function for the quark behaves, for sure. Determining precisely what is the location of the zero crossing, this will give us information about important quantities in QCD, for sure. Like the quark-quark interaction at the end of the day.
Thank you.
May I ask? Hello?
Hi.
May I ask?
Yes, of course.
Yes, I see. Have you any observation the decrease of the neutron mass and nucleus compared to the free state of neutron? Thank you.
So, well, we are performing a computation of hadron properties with t equal to zero, and with I don't know what is the name of that, but with so just in the vacuum, okay? So we are not considering our hadrons surrounded by a medium. What I know, or what I would expect, looking at Nambu-Jonah-Lasinio models, is that you get this smearing of the mass. Okay, so I would expect a reduction of the mass, yes, but I never computed that. That is what I can tell you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, thank you.
Craig, you wanted to comment on or to ask a question?
Yes, thank you, Alexander. I just would like to respond maybe more succinctly to Victor. The answer, I think, Victor, is yes. The proving or establishing unambiguously that there is a zero crossing in GE will be very important for any framework that pretends to describe nucleon structure. In the framework Jorge described, a number of contributing factors play a role. And once the location, existence and location are established, then one can determine which of these is most important. So the answer simply is yes, it should be done. And it can be a justification. It's really very important.
Thank you a lot, Craig. Very encouraging.
All right, so I see no more hand raised. So thank you again, George, for your nice talk.